Hello everyone, welcome back to another episode of Factional Fight Plays Wurm Online. My name is Brian, that's my brother Adam. Sorry everyone in the Twitch stream, Adam's internet connection went down. But for people watching YouTube, you had no idea that that happened. So, what are we doing today? We are going to finally give a tour of our deed, show everybody around. I know last time we just ended while we just got here. So the second thing we're going to do is we're going to decorate a room. This is going to be the first room that I think we're decorating in this new place. Mm-hmm. We're going to look at all the new furniture and all the new stuff that came into the game the last year as far as furniture goes, as much as we can make anyway. And we'll try to make a room look nice. We'll answer questions. We will... what else are we doing? We're doing a number of things. And if you want to know what they are, just wait and find out. So, let's get started. Welcome back, everyone. So, some people might realize that last week we had a really bad problem. For the people that were watching Twitch, we were having really bad problems streaming, and we said, we'll try to fix it for this week. So, if you notice a little bit, things are a little bit different, and I am no longer hosting. My internet connection can no longer support streaming right now.
At least for now.
So, for the first time, Adam's actually the one that's streaming the whole cast. So, who the heck is that freaky guy with the weird beard?
Yeah, I don't think we've ever seen you on camera.
I guess not, maybe once. But everyone's seeing what's happening on your screen, Adam.
Yeah.
And not mine. So I'm just sort of like the passenger of this stream today.
So you probably don't know this about Brian, but every time that he chooses a character or customizes his character in a new game, it's always he always chooses the characteristics that nobody else would choose, or he tries to be different, you know, like the red nose and the red face, that sort of thing.
It's like the best. I was the best Santa Claus this year. I think I have the best hair.
Mm-hmm.
There you go. It actually looks better than my hat. I think I'll keep it off. So, last time we just made it to our deed. And we were showing everybody around. Well, we weren't showing everyone. We were showing this bird's eye view of our deed, and you were saying that you picked the deed or the land because you had this idea of different platforms. Mm-hmm. Is that right?
Well, I mean, it was kind of difficult to find a coastal place on Xanadu that was sort of on the side of Delhi. We sailed up the coast pretty far before finding a spot that was somewhat feasible, I guess you could say. There's a lot of mountains. Like, even in the distance, you can see like that mountain, the range over there. There's a lot of that going on the coast of Xanadu. So when we found this spot, it wasn't great, but at the same time, we could see the potential. It is on the side of a mountain, but there was a lot of grass, there was trees, it was very steep to get to the ground. As you can see, the form of the deed is very slanted. So that was right. Definitely a minus, but I think it was good because our vision was a multi-platformed village. with many ramps leading from this platform to the next. And I kind of wanted to make it so that wherever you were, you could always get to multiple different places. So every platform has lots of different ramps coming off of it. So yeah, this is what ended up happening.
So out of all the places, like, you came back to Xanadu, what made you choose this place?
You know, there was one key feature, and I'll show it to you as we go around the deed. There's one key feature that really attracted me to this place. On the right here, and we're just going to do like sort of like a little tour of the place. This is our tree farm.
This is the topmost area.
Yeah, the topmost platform, yeah.
We just planted some trees. We don't know what we're going to do with this area other than that we need a lot of sprouts right now.
Yeah, I kind of have an idea. The tree farm is going to be temporary. This is going to be sort of like our grand building area. And same with this farm, it's temporary. I think that we're going to raise that land. I don't want to go into too much detail right now, but yeah, this is all going to change up here. So let's go down.
So do you think GPS 51 has a question? Mm-hmm. Do you feel that your adventures on Wild Side, so I guess the...
Oh, no, you're not going to... You can't go this way. You'll have to... Well, you could go that way, actually.
Did it prepare you to build in tiers or on steep terrain?
You know, that's a good question, because the answer is yes, big time. The experiences I had on Chaos really did change the way I looked at terraforming ramps and walls and all that sort of stuff. It really did affect how I looked at leveling and platforms and everything. And I still wouldn't consider myself an expert. There's still a lot to learn in terms of design. But yeah, it really did. It did help. Okay, so this area here is going to be our pens.
This is the token right here.
Oh yeah, that's right.
I think when you deeded this first, there was no ability to deed only in one direction. Is that right? At this place?
You know, I think there was.
Oh, there was?
Yeah, I didn't have to find a center.
Okay, I have no idea what you're talking
about. Yeah. It had just come in. It was, like, really new.
Oh. So we have these pens over here. I guess temporary pens?
Yeah, this is a temporary pen. Yeah, this is, you know.
We sort of have just like big houses here. I don't know if we've figured out why we have them. One of them is the priest house.
Mm-hmm.
And we cleverly named it priest house. I don't know how long it took us to find that name, but it was a while. And then there was here, we had this idea of sort of like a park area. Is that the best way to describe it?
Like an animal sanctuary.
We needed a place. Yeah. We didn't want to do the pens, the regular everyday pens that you see that we've done hundreds of times over. We're like, instead, let's make an animal sanctuary where animals can just roam free within our deed and make it look like a park area. We'll put hedges all the way around. We'll make it look like you're walking through a nice park.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not done.
Yeah.
But you started the hedges here.
That's right.
One, two, three, four, five. We did five hedges out of...
This is what the forest is for, the tree farm.
Yeah, we planted a bunch of cedar. We're going to assume there's cedar all the way around. And we're slowly enchanting the grass.
If you're able to stop for just a second. Yeah, well, whatever.
All right.
I have an enchant that I can waste on that last little bit there.
Oh, but, I see.
You know, I feel like
slowly go back.
I feel like the idea behind this was kind of like we wanted it to be sort of like the Enchanted Garden or whatever it's called. Like we wanted it to be like a garden area.
Secret garden?
The secret garden, that's it. You know, like a big fences to get in, cedar hedges all the way around. You know, when you get in, it's a nice, beautiful garden. There's going
to
be animals
in
here.
It's hard to picture right now.
It's hard to picture right now.
And it's two tiers. It's this bottom tier, and it's this top tier. It's quite large.
That's right.
So, Renewed Path says, do you guys have any plans to set up a market here? And the answer to that is no.
Yeah, not here. Not here. This is a very terrible spot for a market.
Yeah. Yeah, we're not in a place where people are going to come to view our market. In this case, we're going to build a road that we built last episode towards the market. Is that right?
Mm-hmm.
Which is close. I can't remember. What's the market that's nearest us?
Well, technically we're not building a road towards the market that's nearest to us, which is Glass Hollow.
Yeah, but
we are planning a road towards Vrox, which I think also has a market. I don't know how big it is. I've never visited the market near Vrox. But yeah.
Yeah, we'll have a place somewhere in one of the markets that's not our place. Mm-hmm. But this is the second level, and we have all the fencing done. We have to sort of picture that there's going to be hedges around everything here.
Yeah.
So like, you go through this door, and then there'll be hedges just surrounding this.
That's right. Like, yeah.
Allow the animal to roam. Roam free, sort of. We don't have it set up, but
it's coming.
It'll get there eventually. Yeah, so which way do you want to go now?
Well, let's go down. Let's go down. Because up is just a empty tier with some farm on it. This over here is Kaneka's abode. Kaneka is a villager. Longtime friend.
And this is her abode.
She was around with us when we were at Autumn Twilight, helping us out there. She joined up with me on Chaos. And then when I left Chaos, she came here with me. And it's just been her and I and Brian here doing all the work. I have to give nearly all the credit to Kaneka for all the surface mining and terraforming that happened along the back here, which was an insane amount of surface mining. So yeah, that was all Kaneka.
Yeah, she did almost everything. But how big is our deed this time?
It's not.
It's like so much smaller. It's so much smaller than Autumn.
It's not so much smaller, but I'd say it's 3/4 the size of Autumn.
It's a significant amount. What would you say if you had to give it a rough estimate?
Yeah, it's like 3/4 the size of Autumn. I'd say it's like around 65.
For tiles, I mean.
65 by 45, somewhere in that range. Around that.
It's not too bad.
Okay, so we got some empty tiles here. This platform, I'm waiting for bridges. I don't want to go into too much detail. I know a lot of people ask me questions about what I have planned for bridges, but that'll just have to wait and see, because I can tell you my plans, but those might change as we get bridges. So this is the most developed area. This platform on, I guess it doesn't really matter. To our right is the smithery, which is where I have all my stuff going on over there.
Yeah, let's go in there. So, sure. And your mine, which is right next to the smithery.
Yeah, I don't think we're going to go into the mine today. We'll save that for another day. But the smith...
Well, here, you can see Griff's great, messy workstation looks almost exactly the same as Autumn.
It's not messy. Come on. This is way better than Autumn.
It's perfectly neatly tidied of lots and lots and lots and lots of bulk storage bins.
Yeah, I need bulk storage bins for all of these qualities up here, 95, 96, 97, 98, 99. That sort of thing needs to go on. I also need like some some things to organize, like dye making mats. So a lot of the low quality stuff is dye making stuff. Yeah.
So you have a rare forge here.
Mm-hmm.
You took that from Autumn, I guess.
Yep.
And you have a rare forge in here.
Right, I made this one when we were here. I actually made two while here. I realized that if
you... So we have
you...
three rare forges.
Yeah, one of them I made by just combining a whole bunch of rare bricks and clay we had lying around. I did two attempts with that kind of strategy, and one of them was rare, and the other one was not. Yeah, that was interesting.
So you leave it in this room? So this is like the rare forge room.
This room here, I haven't quite decided exactly what's going to go in here, and maybe that rare forge may not stick in this spot.
We are storing a rare forge.
Right.
For future purposes.
Yeah, for whatever we might need it for, or maybe sell it or whatever. I don't even know what to do with it because, I don't know, their value has kind of gone down now that everybody seems to have one. This doesn't seem worth it to sell. But I can't really think of a use for it. Don't really need another rare forge.
Another one?
No.
Wow. A blacksmith doesn't want more than one rare forge. Wow. Yeah.
Why don't we go down that ramp there? This ramp here, I made a time-lapse video of me building this. You can probably find it on the forums somewhere. It was kind of a crazy thing to build. I don't know. That's probably the hardest piece of terraforming on this deed is this ramp here. You can see over there is my boat mine entrance that connects.
Boat mine entrance?
You know, another idea that I had, the vision of this place was on top of the multi-platform tiers was, a insane network of mines underneath that allowed you to get from one place to the next. So here, there, and the other place, there's all these mine entrances that I've created that will hopefully allow for quicker mobility. So I'll be able to sail my boat in here and walk through the mine and come up wherever I need to on my deed. That sort of thing.
Alright, so here's a question by Methodical 13. After all this surface mining that we've done on Autumn and this place, what are your tips for efficient surface mining?
That's a hard one. Tips for surface mining. Put it on a good movie. Good TV show.
No, I would say, what did we do? We started at the top.
Right. Yeah. Started at the top.
And we worked our way down. What, 20 or tiles at a time?
Yeah.
20 so, slope at a time.
Yeah. You start on the back, and you just create a flat row along the back. Go all the way along, create a flat row, and then you take that same row and bring it down 20. And flatten outwards like everything, and then do a whole pass and just keep going like that. You're shaving off levels from top to bottom. It's the best way to do it. It helps to have high mining. It helps to have a really high quality pickaxe, like I'm talking 95 or more.
The one thing that we learned is that surface mining is actually a great way to level your mining from, like, I don't know what I was at, but from 50 almost up to 80 or something is like good skill.
That can easily take you to 80.
Once I got to 80 is like not very good.
But yeah, 80
to the 70s it was still good, like surface mining.
When we were doing the surface mining at Autumn Twilight, I got into the 80s, like low 80s, just doing that from the 70s, from the low 70s. Like it was really good skill, and then it tapers off. You do need to use a skill or pickaxe to get good skill in the 80s or up to the 80s, but no, it's really good skill. And really, it just takes time. Like, you have to have the final vision in your head. This is what I want. And you plan it all out and you just, you know, design to spec, basically. So we have this one big ramp up the, you know, what is this, the west side of our deed, it pretty much has a stop on every tier. So this tier here is empty right now. I'm still deciding plans for it. I think we can take it.
Anyway, the last tip from Budath is that crying yourself to sleep after each day of surface mining tends to help as well.
Yeah.
There's the final tip.
Yeah.
So we were saying there's this level has nothing. There's a lot of levels that have nothing.
Nothing, yeah.
So far, they're just sort of there. But this level does have stuff. We created a house. Mm-hmm. It's sort of like a factory of all of our brick and mortar.
Oh, right.
So
right,
we cleverly decided to call it the brick and mortar factory.
Right. You know, in Autumn Twilight, we had a building that was that had a storage room, and in that storage room was pretty much every bulk item that we had. Bricks and mortar were there, dirt and clay and I don't know, all the wood stuff and nails and all that stuff like that. This time around, I think I was thinking of creating, like, separating that room into multiple buildings so that you had a place that was just bricks and mortar, you have a place that's just wood, lumber yard or whatever. Mm. You know, that way it just feels a little bit more like a village, as opposed to having a single room that houses everything. So yeah, this is our first one. I just finished, I don't know if you noticed in the last video or two videos ago or whatever, this building was not finished.
We talked about a couple things, right? Yeah, well, I don't know. Does anyone notice that? We just saw a bird's eye view. But there's a couple things on this house that we talked about in the last episode. Things that were added to the game after we stopped streaming, which is, the first thing is that there's no wooden border.
Yes.
From the first tier to the second tier. The second thing is that these plain narrow stone windows, that's new.
Right.
I like these windows.
Yeah. I like these windows, except for when you're on the inside looking out, you don't get a wide view out of them, really. Like, it's very, very much like as if there's no window there. The other thing, if you can back up and just sort of look through the arches there, another thing they added, this is really something I really like, and that is you're allowed to build fences inside archways.
That's right.
So because our deed is on this like massive slope, I thought that it was a good, it would be a good strategy to just use archways so that you get a really massive view. It's almost like a really big window, and then just put a little fence here. I chose the chain fences because they're the lowest. They're also the least obtrusive. I kind of like the look of them.
They stop you from falling to your death.
I really wish they would make them just slightly higher, because as they are now, the chain kind of clips right into the floor, which I think is just... I don't think that they wanted that to happen, but it just does. It should be up a little bit higher, but... I like the look
of
the chain.
The list. And then the last thing is the trellises, which were not around.
Right.
When we last streamed.
This was me just trying to figure out the trellises, and I put it here because it fit, and then it just sort of stayed there.
You just put it down. It's like, how do these look? They look okay. Mm-hmm. And then you just forgot about it.
That's right.
I actually really like them.
Yeah. They do add something nice about them, yeah, for sure. This here wooden building was the first building we made. The first thing we did when we got here, like, it was like all natural, like everything was tons of willow trees. This place is crowded with willow trees, you can barely see. We flattened out our first platform. This was it. And we built this house. It started out as a 2x3, and then we expanded it later. So a little house and a little horse pen, and it was just the first pen. We expanded the pen to add another one when we got more horses. But for the most part, this was our home base, and everything else was like a work in progress. And now that
it's like just a horse pen, a bull pen, a sheep pen, and a rare forge pen.
Yeah, and there's another rare forge. This is the one I just made it, and I'm like, wow, I made another rare forge, and then I just left it here. I haven't moved it since.
Put it down in the enchanted grass. It's the perfect place for a forge. And you have your I guess, your souvenir from being on Chaos, which is this Ebonora
a memento
banner.
Or two. Yeah.
Mm. Those are
I
nice.
Love that. I love that logo. Looks really cool.
Hmm. What is this storage solutions?
Right. This the idea for this was a place to store all of our. If you can move, I'm kind of in a wall. Place to store all of our crates, and bulk storage bins and rafts and like just extra, because before they were just all sitting where this bulk where this crate is sitting. It was just right in this middle here. And I wanted to clear off that space, so I built a building, called it Storage Solutions, and it'll just be a place where we can put all of our empty, what do you call them? Bins? Crates? Bulk storage bins? That sort of stuff.
So, let's just make it clear. When we first started here, we littered this place with crates and bulk storage bins, like this level, especially.
Yeah, this whole area.
Since then, we built houses and we cleaned up this area, all but this one crate.
That's right.
We stopped short at cleaning it up by one crate.
This
and
one
there was like 20 or 30 crates.
This one crate I actually just put here sometime this week, and it was just me being lazy. I should have probably not put it there, but that's what happened.
Well, that ruins the story. But let's go up to... I think that's it. I mean, other than the fact that we have a random bear just there. Yeah. But that's our deed.
Oh, before we go here, we should pick up some bricks and mortar. I forgot to mention that.
And where are they?
In the bricks and mortar factory.
Oh. I guess I should have realized that.
The deed does have a long way to go. I do look forward to working on it. It is a long-term goal. A long-term project. Oh, nice. I got kicked off the cart.
That's it, right? That's our deed. There's nothing special. Nothing big about it. Which side has the actual bricks?
The bricks are on the left, yeah. So, back up, yeah. So if you want to load those up.
I don't know if I have space.
You want me to load them up? I found this new way. Like this, when they added the wagons, I found a way of loading up carts. If you hold shift and enter at the same time and just drag it over, it sort of, you saw those menus go. It essentially scrolls through the menus for you if you hold shift and enter. And you can just sort of keep dragging like this. You filled up this thing pretty good. We will need mortar. Mortar can fit into the backpacks though. Okay. I don't think we need that many bricks and mortar. That should be enough.
Do you have mortar?
Mortar's on the other side. So that one bin over there that's against the narrow window.
The one bin.
To our right. No, to the other right. all the way on the other side of the building compared to these ones holding stone. Yeah, that one right there. Yeah, that's our mortar.
Okay. And this mortar can be added to...
I'll just put a bunch in the
backpacks.
Backpacks, yeah. We don't need that much, I don't think. Okay, we're good.
There was already mortar in there.
So there's a question about... we have always avoided this question. In all of our videos, we've had people asking this question, and we've avoided it. Until I think we are allowed... I feel comfortable answering this question. The question is, how did you get more BSBs? Yeah, I'll tell you why in a second. How do you get more BSBs than one? on a tile like that, like how I have them all lined up, or, you know, if you saw those, that pile of like 10 BSBs just sitting in one spot. The way to get BSBs like that now is to plant them. If you plant them, then you can push them on top of each other. And I think the limit is 15 per tile still. But you can push them and pull them and rotate them and whatever. And they slide right up on top of each other if you plant. The downside to planting is that only the person who planted them can actually pick them up, unless they're on a deed or something like that. But it used to be that you kind of had this wiggle room to be able to drop two BSBs on top of each other, and I think that wiggle room is still there. A lot of times, like if you have lots of BSBs in your inventory, you'll probably try this. If you have like four or five BSBs in your inventory and you drop, like you just click the pile of them and drop, sometimes, yeah, rarely, they just all like plop down all at once. Like you'll notice that happens. So you can use a similar strategy to kind of get them like that without planting. But yeah, right, that's the way it is. I think it's a bug, but one that has been reported.
It's a game feature.
It's a game feature, right? It's a game feature.
Yes.
But planting them is the way I do it now. I just plant them all.
So we went. We're going to decorate one of the rooms in the smithery. Mm-hmm. So we're here in the smithery, and we need to get the cart up there. All of our stuff is in this cart. How do we do that?
Right. I'm not sure if this is going to actually work. I'll be honest. It works sometimes. This is in a situation where you need to bring a lot of materials upstairs. It seems like the best way to do it now is, what you do is you bring the cart right underneath the ladder here.
Yeah.
Now, again, this is another one of those game features that I wish they polished a little bit more. I'm going to show you this place a little bit. Okay, so if you want to climb up here, this is sort of like a hallway slash landing slash way to the balcony sort of thing.
Not quite a room, but
it's gonna be, it's, you can look down, it's what I call the loft. It's a loft. Okay, when you look down the hole, you can see the cart still there, right? So what I'm going to do, we don't want to decorate this room. We will eventually, but not today. We're going to climb up one more time, and what I've created here is a bedroom. It's going to be a bedroom. And this is kind of interesting. I wish that they polished this feature a little bit more. You can still click the cart and embark Commander, and sometimes this works. I'm crossing my fingers that it's going to work this time. When I embark Commander, oh goodness, it's telling me I need to get closer to the cart. But sometimes, let's try this, climb down. Let's do it one floor at a time. That sometimes fixes the problem. You gotta fiddle with it a little bit. The cart kinda comes with you. See that?
And kind of comes with you.
Comes with you. And I can disembark, climb up again, and the cart will again, if I embark Commander, it kind of comes with me. And you can drive it around, but you'll notice that every so often when I stop, it sort of bugs out. You see that? And really what it's doing when it bugs out like that is it's returning back to the floor it was on previously. So it's like, but you see how when I stand here, if I move forward a little bit more, the horses are here, everything's not bugged out, and I can disembark when it's like that, and I remain on this floor and embark. So that's, again, I wish a game feature that they were to polish that and make it work like I'm describing here. One thing that, if you're going to use this, make sure that when you disembark, make sure the cart isn't flickering between floors, and you just sort of move over, and after everything settles down, it just allows you to disembark. Because if you disembark when the cart's flickering like that, you can get into a bug where you can't get access to your card anymore. I've been there, and you need a GM to help get it out sometimes. Okay, so again, embark up again, and poof. So I want to make sure when I stop and everything stops, the cart's here, and I can disembark, and we now have crates and carts and all of our mats in this room here.
Well done. Okay. So this place has a balcony. That's pretty cool.
Yeah. So my original thought of this little place was like a little room, like a bedroom with a little balcony, and at some point or another we'll get to maybe decorating the balcony. Maybe we'll have time today. I don't know. I doubt it, but the balcony should have, you know, a table and chairs and, you know,
new items. What stuff should we make first out of the new items? So we have a canopy bed, a coffer, fine high chair, high bookshelf, lounge chair, low bookshelf, royal throne, royal lounge chase.
Okay. So I know we got a ton of new stuff.
What do you guys think in the chat? What should we make first out of all these things? I've never made any of this stuff yet.
My feeling is that we should probably make a bed first, and then build the room about that.
You need a popper's high chair, right?
Popper's high chair. You know, my feeling for this room would be like a bed, a fireplace, a nice cozy fireplace with a nice rug, and, you know, some bookshelves and a wardrobe, and I think we're going to fill up the room pretty quickly. It's only a 3x3, but I think we can decorate it pretty nicely.
All right, no one agrees with me. No one wants to make the popper chair. I think we got the most canopy beds, so let's figure out how to make a canopy bed.
Okay, one thing about the canopy bed that I realized I forgot.
Do you think? Something that we you got to go get the, what is it called, the sheets or whatever you need, but ever since they added the crafting window into this game, which happened just before we stopped streaming, I think, or doing videos.
Yeah, it came.
And they added so that we have the crafting window and the crafting recipe in the game. So at this point, there's not really a need for Wurmpedia, but at the same time, there is. Like, there's benefits to both. What do you use?
I use both. If it's a matter of trying to make something, I'm so sitting here with mats and I want to like figure out
Wurmpedia.
Yeah, if I want to make
you
something,
come back into the game.
Sorry. I'll use the game. I'll use the recipes in the game in the crafting window.
That's what you guys in the chat. Do we still use Wurmpedia, or has the crafting recipe window taken over? And why? I still use Wurmpedia. I don't know. I need to see that picture of what I'm doing. Canopy bed.
Oh, I realize my hotkeys on this computer aren't the same, so... Okay, so for the canopy bed...
Headboard and bed frame.
Canopy bed starts off very similar to the regular bed. I think the combine is the same, and you have the option of doing one or the other. The only difference is that it takes a lot more materials and requires a high level of fine carpentry in order to...
Oh, high level of fine carpentry? You never told me that.
Well, I didn't figure it was a problem. I think the high level is like 65 or something is the cutoff.
Where are we going to get some of the 65 carpentry? fine carpentry, I should say. I don't know. But we have, so we'll see if we can do this.
The thing
I think a lot of veterans that are used to use Wikipedia or Wurmpedia probably still use Wurmpedia because we are still used to it. But I wonder.
You know, here's one thing that I can't stand about the crafting recipes thing, and I'll show you here. Is let's say you are making a canopy bed, right? Canopy bed. Okay. And you're like, okay, great. I need a headboard and a bed frame. And I need all this stuff. Okay, how to make a headboard. So you go, okay, I want to make a headboard now. I click on headboard, and it tells me everything about a headboard. And let's say I go and make the headboard. Now I want to go back to the canopy bed. I just wish there was a back button. You know what I mean? Like, go back to the previous screen, because now I have to go back here, and step one is type in canopy bed again in order to get there.
Oh, yeah, that is really annoying.
Yeah. Which You're is right. really annoying. All it needs is a back button and maybe even a forward button, and it should be sort of functional for me.
A back and a forward button. There you go. So if any devs are watching that could do that. Adam wants a back and forward button. Make it happen. So canopy bed, that's the first thing we're doing. We need, if I just look at this correctly,
all of this stuff.
Cotton sheets. What is a cotton sheet? And 8 furs. Do we have 8 furs?
Yeah, I might need to bring those over. Yep, we do have 8 furs.
Okay. So bring over the 8 furs. So it looks like, let's see. Xandaros uses Wurmpedia because, of course, he's used to it.
Yep. A lot of people use Wurmpedia because you're used to it. I still use Wurmpedia for a lot of things.
Well, then you might want to use to know how much of it you need weight-wise, and the in-game crafting recipe doesn't tell you in-game weight-wise.
Yeah, that's true.
That's a good point. What does it say here? Tuanta, I don't know if I'm saying that right, uses both because what else would we do at work? That's a good point.
So that is a good, point. Very valid point.
Idle humor, when I look for recipes for stuff, I always go to the Wurmpedia because the wiki has extra information and links to what you might need information for. Yeah.
So you definitely are crafting stuff over there, right? I don't quite hear anything going on.
Yes.
Okay.
I'm not like stopping crafting just to read the chat. Yeah. Of course not.
Okay.
So yeah, +1 to the back button. Let's make it happen. Back button for the crafting recipe.
It would make a big difference, I think, to the functionality of it. Sometimes I'm getting frustrated with that aspect of it, I switch over to the Wurmpedia.
Yeah. Yeah, I probably would too if I used the crafting recipe and not Wurmpedia or anyway. So, I mean, we're getting all this new stuff, and at the same time, they're upgrading and changing the graphics for the old items. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like the old loom and the old chairs.
Here's the new loom.
Bulk storage bins.
All the bulk storage bins got updated. Oh, goodness.
What else? Barrels? Did barrels get updated? No, maybe not yet. Or did they? They did, didn't they?
No.
Barrels? Small barrels?
Barrels are still the same old barrels.
Buckets?
Although I wouldn't be surprised if those are the next things to go.
I don't know. Maybe not. But like all these things are getting upgraded, and as they're getting upgraded, we're losing the ability that different wood types have different colors or different textures. Bulk storage bins, for example. Now, they did say that in the future, something about tinting, I don't know.
Shaders.
Hue, shaders, something, new colors later at some point. TM.
Some point soon.
We don't know. Yeah. What do you think right now?
You know, I like the new textures. I like the upgrades to the, but you know, losing the capability of creating a bulk storage bin that is, let's say, cherry wood, and it stands out compared to the others, losing that ability sort of just it does change something about the game. It makes like this massive row of bulk storage bins just look kind of bland in comparison to what it looked like before. Or although all these are, some of them are birchwood, some of them are willows, which I was pretty random with these, to be honest. But I know I read a post about somebody who organized all of their stuff based on, like, all of the cherry wood has stone in it, and all of the willow ones have such. So he was able to tell what was in it based on the type of wood, and was complaining right when all the wood got changed. But the same goes for the new bolt models, which are coming soon as well. And, you know, people had a preference towards applewood, or some people liked the rustic look of oak or whatever. And I think that's all going to go. And I think we're going to lose a little piece of something that some of the charm of this game when that happens, until it gets, fixed, I guess,
fixed
by the shaders.
Yeah. Hopefully that is not years away.
Mm-hmm.
But you're right. There is a charm that's lost with the fact that we don't. You know, in the meantime, shouldn't they just give us the ability to die like bulk storage bins?
Yeah, I think that's also being handled by this new shader thing. Buddha, who I believe, if I am not mistaken, is Buddha, one of the devs, says, there's a full rewrite of the engine that's been in progress for months. Once that's completed, it'll open up a whole lot of things we can do for this kind of stuff. And that is awesome news. And I know I've heard this news. It's one of these things that I haven't really been that vocal about, because I know that it's coming, I know that it's being worked on. I just wish it was here, but you know, that's the same with everything, I guess. It's just things take time, and we'll see it when it's here.
Yes, so I need to figure out what I'm doing.
Yeah, I know, I'm sort of just hitting the create button, which is
canopy bed. So I'm going to, I made a bed frame and I made a headboard, and I can't really see what I'm doing. But think of it this way.
Right,
I'm only using maybe 30 to 40 quality level material, which is really small. But I have a 64% chance to create the canopy bed.
Mm-hmm.
Now, to couple that with the fact that I have 96.7 fine carpentry.
Right. This apparently is a hard thing to make. And a lot of people, I know Kaneka has been dying to have one. She's threatened to steal it from you, from this room.
We're going to make it, and then next week we're good. Where's our bed? And Kaneko would be like, I don't know. Okay, so what do I need to do? I need to add this to the crafting window. All right, so now I can see what I need. I need a footboard, fur, large nails, planks, and sheets, and let's see what I can do. What do I got?
Oh, that's the loom sound. Is that a new loom sound?
Hold on. Let's play that again. No, it's not.
No, it's the same loom sound. Maybe I just... I don't generally play with my sound on, so I guess I don't become familiar.
There's a way to make everything new. just for like a year, just turn off worm sounds. And then one day, just turn it on and be like, oh my god, this is like the best thing ever.
I did that.
I can hear... Is that like a new hammer sound? I can hear it from the distance.
You know, I did that, and just recently I turned it on and I heard this. Oh, it's not even on this computer. The emotes, I can't hear them.
I heard that.
Yeah, you heard it because you have it set to, but I don't know what's going on with this computer. Why I can't hear the emotes.
You can't hear the emote? Oh, that's weird.
No, is there a setting specifically for emotes? I guess I don't know.
I don't think so. I don't know why it wouldn't be on for you. It's something to do with your headphones. I don't know. Do you have the sounds off? If you go into settings?
Anyway, I have the sounds so on. I heard it, but hear stuff. But yeah, anyway.
I don't know if I want to talk about that.
Okay.
Not this episode. Being really cryptic. But... But I was in the middle of actually making a point.
Okay, sorry.
What was the point? Canopy, 64%. Nice. I am 96 quality, or 96 level of fine carpentry. Now, granted, I was using 40 quality level items, and I did make the canopy bed. Like, it's not like I didn't. I made the beginning of it, I should say.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Do you feel okay that having items like this that are very high level adds or detracts from the game?
You mean having items that are only accessible by high level crafters?
Right. So here's a bed that can only be accessible for people that play the game and get to high level in fine carpentry. Do you like that? There's most items in this game you can level and, you know, become decent 30, 40 level in this game and still be able to make most of the stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the stuff.
And when we started playing, it was like that, where you create a brand new character and pretty much anything you could make.
The only thing that was stopping you was like leveling it up, imping it, improving it up to a higher level.
Right.
Now there's all these items that were added to the game where you can only make them unless you spend the time to level up that profession. What do you think of that?
Personally, I kind of like it. I like the addition of items that can only be made at higher levels because it then gives more of a reason to raise that skill. It gives you that incentive. A new item came out, like the canopy beds, when they first came out, tons of people were saying, oh, now I got to level up my fine carpentry. It gives people a reason to do it, you know? And it also adds later game... goals or things to unlock. Just adds motivation. You know, you want that new shiny thing. I like it personally. I wish there was more.
So I'm gonna have to disagree with you.
Yeah.
Because I love it.
Wait, I said I love it.
Yes. No, you said you like it.
Okay.
Anyway. This is what I've been wanting, I don't know, for forever. I love that you can make a lot of items in this game without needing to be high level. But there needs to be items that distinguish the low levels from the high levels more than just improving an item. So the fact that there are more items in this game now than a year ago that can distinguish a veteran from a new player, I really love it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it gives us veterans something to actually provide to the newbie, to the new players, or stuff that new players can look up to when they see us and maybe aspire to. Because we had this conversation before, like, you know, that you start the game, you learn the mechanics, you start a deed, you build your house, you make your forge, you make all the stuff, and you start a farm maybe, and then what?
Mm-hmm.
You just made everything that you wanted to make. The only thing left is now that you can improve them from 20 quality to, I don't know, 60 quality.
That's right. Yeah, I feel like we need more of that. Like
unlocking items.
Keep going in that direction, and just make more of that stuff that we need to unlock as we get higher and higher. Gives a reason to grind a skill. More motivation.
Yeah, so I think everybody in the chat was basically agreeing towards that same thing. So, yeah, good move.
Mm-hmm.
Keep going. And definitely expand that further, and we talked about this in the last episode, expanding it in different ways,
mm-hmm.
if that's even possible. And one thing that I didn't talk about, I'd like to bring up this idea. I don't know if it's possible, but it's just sort of like a fantasy idea that I've had for the longest time for this game. So, if anybody that's important enough is listening,
Buddha.
Group, yeah, group crafting.
You and go on and that, on about this all the time. Group crafting, group crafting, group crafting.
By that, I don't mean we're all standing by the foot of a colossus hammering in bricks. I mean, actually, a game, not even a game, like cooperation to create an item. And there's many ways that I've been like thinking about how it could work in a game like this, where you need people to be crafting at the same time to make this item. You need that group cooperation, that MMO, you know, you need to ask your neighbor to come and help you.
Mm. That's the key, where you need to ask somebody to come and help you. I don't know how it could be implemented in the game. Like, I know you've described a bunch of
I know places. How it could be implemented.
Okay,
in
maybe
game.
You do, but I feel like the key is being able to say to your friend or your neighbor, can you come over to my deed so that we can make this thing? I need help making this thing. And they physically have to come over and do something to make the thing. That would add a lot of immersion to the game, I think.
Okay, hold on. Serious question time.
Okay.
Is your hat on inside out or is your camera mirrored? My camera's actually mirrored.
Yeah.
There you go. There's the secret. Why do we do that?
I can look that way. Yeah.
And face Adam inwards like this.
Yeah. Otherwise he's facing the outside of the screen and that looks kind of silly.
Yeah. That's the only reason why we do that. Yeah. Anyway, yeah, so that's why everything looks backwards. Anyway, so there are some ways to do this, like Renewed Path is bringing up that, you know, you must link sometimes
mm-hmm.
when you're a priest. Mm-hmm. You can do it like that. But what I was thinking was we used to play this game on the iPad or the iPhones, called Space Team.
We still play this game.
I don't know if anybody's played this game, but it's so much fun when you're playing with a group. And I don't think any of these ideas have been implemented into any MMOs I played, although I haven't played any more recent MMOs. This would be perfect for building or transferring this sort of idea to building something in Wurm, where you need two or more people. And how would you describe this? Okay, so one person would be like having to add an item. No, sorry. One person, you get on your screen something that the other person needs to add or do to the item that's being crafted. But the person that needs to craft it doesn't see that item that needs to be crafted. Does this make sense?
See, right now we're not. I don't think that we're suggesting this is how it should work in Wurm, but this is sort of just like in this game, how it forces you to work together. Like, one person has to say what's on the screen. Add the, and it's like such a ridiculous word, like the Kahoot or whatever, like some nonsense words. So you have to say add the Kahoot to the fizzle pot
out loud
or whatever. You have to say it out loud so the other person hears you, and on their screen they have
all these things on their screen
that are just named all sorts of things, and they have to find the Kahoot and bring it to the fizzle pop or whatever. And that sort of thing's happening simultaneously between, it could be up to four people, and everybody's shouting random stuff at each other. It's a lot of fun.
Yeah, it oh, that should be in this game. Oh, we should be building this canopy bed, and you'd be like, insert the shaft there, insert the shaft there, and you have about 10 seconds to do that.
Yeah. Like Buddha saying, like needing two people to add the same time, two items to the same time to the building progress. Like, maybe, but we have no idea how it would work exactly. Like, my feeling is that, you know, the specifics we haven't really thought through perfectly, but it would just be nice.
Something like it can't be timed, but it would require more than one person to put it together. I'd say
a collaborative effort. You need to get it. Like, here's bridges, for example. We have been told will require two people to start the bridge.
Make it some items, and I know that a lot of people don't like to be social. Well, then you don't get these items. Like, they can't be that important. They can't be items that need to be made.
And then there's also people who will say, well, why don't you just get an alt and you can do it with alts or whatever, you know? There's always that sort of
thing. But this game is an MMO, and it should breed or foster the, you know, collaboration with at least some people.
You know, another thing that I felt this way in this game that was kind of like this was one of the missions where you had to, I don't even remember exactly what it was, but there was like a pillar sort of thing that you had built near our castle on Autumn Twilight. And when a certain mission came up where you had to congregate around this thing, you needed three people to come and right click this item, and I can't remember what it was. It was kind of like praying or sort of. What do you remember what it was?
Sorry, say that again.
Where there was like a pillar that you built by our, by the castle, and one of those missions would come up and it would say you would need three people to something. I don't even know what. And we would have to call our neighbors.
You need three people to pray or something at the. Yeah, you're right. At the pillar.
At the pillar.
So we would have to call people in, and it was like this big pillar, and it just looked like a regular pillar. and you would have to just pray at the exact same time, and that finished the mission for you.
Yeah,
or something like that.
It was just another excuse to have somebody come visit your deed. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah,
just an excuse to get off your deed, go visit somebody else's place, and do something that requires both of you to do it. You know, it really doesn't have like. I don't know. It just promotes the social aspect of it. This is taking forever, by the way. I never really realized, because I just started with the cloth tailoring, I never realized how much...
How big a cotton sheet is?
How big a sheet is, and I need 8 of them. And I should have done this before. Like, I should have... Oh, and I have a bug where I can't... You guys see this? See this bug?
What's happening?
I don't have the menus, the sub-menus coming up when I scroll over. But I can probably get around it using the crafting window. I've had this bug before, but it's been a while.
Yeah, I remember a long time ago I had it. Anyway, I'm almost done my part of the canopy bed, so all we'll be missing is the furs and
the sheets?
Cotton sheets.
Okay.
Yeah. So I just gotta finish a footboard, and then I'll move on to the next item.
Okay, wait. I think I made one too many sheets, and... okay, well...
Okay, so which item do you want me to create next? Anybody in the chat have any suggestions? Do we care that this is going to end up being a pine wood?
And I'm forgetting the furs. Is it going to be a pine wood?
Oh, I can also make it a chestnut bed? Or maple wood. Okay, maple... chestnut or linden wood.
Do you want me to bring? I can bring any of the other pieces of wood.
No, those are the three options, or pine wood. Which one should I make it?
Yeah, let's leave it up to the audience.
Okay, so once again, maple wood, chestnut, or linden wood or pine wood. Do you hear that?
What am I listening for?
It's nighttime. It's crickets.
Yeah, crickets, nighttime. That's the way it is.
Nobody has any suggestions? I don't have lemon wood. Lindenwood. Did I say lemon wood? Lindenwood.
Yeah, I think it doesn't matter too much because it's all going to look the same. Oh, oh, I see. I do have the ability to submenu. It's all going to look
for
the
now,
same.
It'll all look the same. Do I have a saw? I do.
Okay, so I'm going to put this in piles here.
I hope this is all I need to do to make it Lindenwood. It's for any new player that's watching our stream. In order to make an item a particular wood type, it's the last piece of wood that goes into the item that determines.
Mm-hmm. See, we technically don't have all the woods available to us right in this moment, and I think that we're gonna just have to use what we got, or else it's gonna take forever to go run and grab it. One thing that I'm noticing is I'm probably gonna need to reset my client to get these menus back.
Okay.
Let's just figure out how long I can go without doing that, but...
Okay. Alright, so I'm making the canopy bed. Any ideas of what we should be making next? Maybe some chairs? What kind of chair? Let's do a chair. What are our options? We have the lounge chair, the royal throne, the pauper's high chair. Those are a wooden bench.
I want at least a lounge chair in this place.
At least a lounge chair. Okay,
yeah.
Adam wants a lounge chair. Let's see what it takes. Lounge chair.
Oh, goodness.
Are you sure you want the lounge chair and not the... the Royal Lounge Chase?
Let me double check what it looks like. Maybe it could be the Royal Lounge Chase.
Oh god, we would need 2 yarn, 10 square pieces of wool cloth. We don't have 10 square pieces of wool cloth. Do you?
I might. I'll have to go relegate myself back to the tailoring station.
Okay.
But let me see.
Okay, let me see.
I think I'm going to have to go back there anyway. No, what was it that I wanted? It looked like
the lounge chair needs 4 tar.
It wasn't the chair. It wasn't the lounge chair now that I think about tar. It looked like the chase, but it wasn't. It was more like, it was almost like a lazy boy sort of thing.
Royal Lounge Chase.
Was it the Royal Lounge Chase? Almost like a
lazy boy. Type in Royal Lounge Chase.
Yeah, I looked at it. But it wasn't quite that. Oh. I guess a lounge chair almost looks more like something for the deck. It has a little ottoman.
What kind of room are we trying to make here?
Yeah, I guess that's for outside. Okay, so maybe the Royal Lounge Chase. I think we have
but
enough
do
stuff.
You have...
I do have enough stuff. I'm just going to have to go back. You know, really, this is something that happens every episode. We always seem to take longer than we anticipate to do stuff.
That's okay.
Yeah, it's okay.
Why is it okay? Because we have, oh man, a whole bunch of questions here. There's one thing that we wanted to do, and there's a lot of questions that come up on the forums. I know you read the forums a lot, Adam. And you wanted to answer some of these questions that just appear on the forums. So you wrote some of them down that you were interested in. So let's do one of those while you're doing that.
Sure.
Here's a question. So somebody posted this long post about, just discovering the game just today. And they wanted to know, if it was possible to play this game casually. Do you feel like you can sit down and play this game 3 hours a night and be successful?
Is 3 hours a night casual?
2 hours a night and be...
Let's put it this way. Like, it depends on what your definition of casual is. You know, some people might look at casual as sitting down for a couple hours every week, once a week. You know, you get your games night and you have a few hours once a week. You probably couldn't keep this game up because a lot of things happen on time frames. Like, for example, farming. You could plant your farm and then 1 week goes by and you come back and it could be dead, for example. And decay and all that stuff could take your stuff within a week. So if you're talking, you're going to log in every day, you got a couple hours in the evening every day, 100% you can for sure play this game. You know, even if it was a couple hours every other day, you probably could still manage to play this game on a that would be considered a casual level for this game, I'd say. What I love about this game is that it does allow you to AFK a lot. Like, you could be doing what I'm doing right now, you know, hit the create button, and then I often have to AFK because I have kids, and I know a lot of people who play who have kids who say they play this game specifically because it allows them to just get up from the game, do what they need to do in real life, and then come back and just, you know, make a few more items, that sort of thing. So yeah, for sure you could play casually if it's a couple hours here and there.
Okay. Not bad. But can you play as a free player? Is it feasible to play as a free player? Does anybody here play as a free player?
That's a good question. I know people who played as a free player. I don't know if you remember this guy, but he lived next to Puzzle Plaza when we were living there. And this was before we even made videos. And he was like a role-playing free player. He would go into this like way of speaking. I don't know if you remember him. What is his name?
Snod?
Yeah, Snod. That was his name.
All right. Yeah. Snod. Me Snod.
He would always refer to himself in first person. He would always talk in a specific way. It was really interesting. I don't think he stuck around for very long. We had a free player who was living next door to us for quite a while, maybe a couple months. He just started and was playing the free player. My feeling, though, is that you can't keep it up for long because you hit a point where you've just hit the ceiling. It's almost like you've hit the end game for a free player, and then you're sort of stuck there. At the same time, you're noticing all the other things that people are doing that are amazing that you can't because you're a free player. You can't ride horses or carts, or you can't ride boats that are larger than a rowboat.
So you believe that Wurm is a free trial, or a game, a subscription game with a free trial, and not a free-to-play game?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I would say it's not a free-to-play game, and if you're coming in here thinking this is a free-to-play game, you're going to be disappointed. It's definitely not feasible, I don't think, to play long-term as a free-to-like, you know, that first week or two where you're just exploring the game and things are fresh and new and, you know, for sure you can get by in the free-to-play.
Yeah.
But you definitely
hit
a ceiling.
I was trying to think back. For us, we started the game. Yeah. And I remember we're thinking, like, you know, we can play forever on free to play. We're going to get all these skills up to 20. And then we're going to premium, and then we're going to keep going. And you're like 1 week in.
Yeah.
You come to me, you're like, okay, I'm going premium.
Yeah.
Let's do this.
I know.
And I'm like, okay, and your
wait, sorry, if I could just stop you a second before I make all this. Did we need yarn of wool, or did we need square pieces of wool?
You're talking about the lounge thing?
Yeah.
We need 2 yarn and 10 square piece of wool cloth.
Oh, goodness. We won't have enough for that.
Okay, so we should not do this.
Yeah,
so
we should not make that one, yeah. We have 4. Okay. I have 4 sitting here. I have 5 and enough to make 3 more, maybe.
Not make the lounge chair today. That's okay.
Yeah, that's okay.
I'm going to do what I've been wanting to do, and I'm going to create the popper chair. Here we go.
Okay. what I do want is also a carpet. I haven't made one of these carpets yet.
Okay, you do the carpets, and I will make 2 popper chairs.
What am I doing?
Which requires shafts, planks, small nails. Small nails.
You know, I only just started collecting wool from our sheep maybe a week ago. I should have started earlier than that, but I didn't have a cloth tailor, just was one day, I'm like, you know what? I kind of like the look of those carpets. I'm going to just skill up my cloth tailoring And that was maybe a week and a half ago, and I got it up to 40 some odd, enough to make the carpets and enough to make whatever I need to make. Which is,
yeah,
which
that's
goes
one
back.
Thing that,
sorry.
Yeah, it goes, that's one sorry, thing that we don't have is a cloth tailor.
Yeah.
Out of all of our characters, we've never decided to level that skill. That's a little strange. But anyway, sorry.
It goes back to that idea of having things to make that require higher levels. Like, for example, I spent probably 3 hours, 4 hours of sleep bonus, got my skill to 40 some odd, and now I can pretty much make whatever I need to make. Like, I can make the carpets. I don't think there's anything else I need to unlock, except for maybe an exquisite meditation rug, which, and then there's also, of course, the imping of all these things, but I'm talking purely like I can now make all the things I need to make with 40 skill, and I don't have any real reason to skill
What's
it up
tapestries?
Unless I can make what needs to be made with the tapestries. Ooh, I just got a
really?
Supreme string of cloth.
Higher level. Oh wow!
Yeah.
Wow.
Nice.
We can hold on to those. They'll be worth something one day.
I do have an altar right here. Just pop it right in there.
All right. So, yeah, the only reason why I want to make these popper chairs is because of the name.
What do they look like? What are we going to make our... What is this house going to look like? No. Popper chair. Popper's high chair actually kind of looks nice.
It does?
Yeah. So...
It's good to know. It's good to know. I'm not wasting my time.
You know what? So I think from here I can make a rug... Let me just double check this. Not a rug, but a...
What are they called?
What are they called? Carpets. Carpets. What?
The carpets? Are they called rugs?
Floor loom and a string of cloth, so I do need to stay here with the loom. This is only
the animal rugs we do somewhere.
This is only a temporary tailoring. I haven't set up an official one. This loom we made we first started this place. We put a loom down because we needed something. I can't remember. And we made it out of willow because we didn't have access to oak at the time. And so this is.
Just sort of what we did.
Yeah.
And we have not fixed it since then.
Haven't fixed it. So at some point or another, I'm going to make a tailoring place. It might be a tailoring building or something like that.
Yeah. So here's an interesting question. You're a new player and you've started the game. You leveled to 20 in some skills and you're ready to go premium. The game has sold you and said, I want to figure out the rest of this game. I'm going to buy into it. I'm interested to see what the rest of the game has to offer. I go and I premium. What do I do first?
Mm-hmm. Well, depends on what you've done. My feeling is find a place and deed it. A place that you want to call your home.
Wouldn't I have already found a place and deeded? You can deed when you're not premium, right? Is that the way
right.
it works?
Yeah, they changed that. That's a really good change, I think.
So that's done.
Okay.
So what do you do first? You're premium now. What do you guys do first in the chat? I am a new player and I just premiumed and I'm on the forums and I'm saying, what do I do now? I'm sold on this game. I'm now premium. What can I do?
Mm-hmm.
What should I do? What have I unlocked here?
What have you unlocked?
I just gave you my money.
good question. You might want to be aiming for masonry to build the stone houses.
Masonry, so there's an idea. Straight to surface mining. Yeah, make one of each tool and imp them all the best to your ability. Huh?
Skill up characteristics so you can ride
up. That's true.
Ride carts, yes, carts and horses. Get the horse thing going.
So
on.
For characteristics, that's for carts would be and
mind
boats,
logic.
That's mind logic.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that's probably what I would want to do. Because that's the easiest one to do. It's harder to actually ride a horse. Much easier to ride a cart with horses hitched to it.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, grinding body control. Is there any new ways of grinding body control, or is it just all like arrows and hitting?
You know, they
trees
they changed body control to get better gains on certain things. Like for example, I'm doing the cloth tailoring thing, and I'm noticing the body control gains are awesome. Even at pretty high skill. So I think that carpentry also got a nice little boost in that area. So I think that...
So maybe there are some different ways.
Yeah. Now here's... I'm in a debate mode. Do I want a large colorful carpet? The medium or the small? And I think that each one has a set color.
Right.
Kind of wish there was a way of choosing the color after, like choose a size and choose a color sort of thing, but if you choose the largest one, you have to go with yellow. The medium one is blue and the small one is red. I kind of like red as a color for a carpet.
Mm-hmm.
But I also wish I could make the big one red. Let's go with
so
the small
what,
one.
I don't mind. Yeah, whatever you like.
I'm just gonna go with the small one. Yes, wiki pictures. Yes, that's what I'm looking at right now. So yes, that's a definitely an extra feature. Huh? Did I make it? What happened? I create a small colorful carpet. There it is.
Do you make it and then it's done, or do you have to add stuff to it?
No, I make it and it's done. Can I imp it? Probably. Came out at 8 quality, so I sure hope I can imp it.
Well, okay. I think we should definitely get to the questions.
Mm-hmm.
We asked this week, just like last week, people to leave us questions, just community questions. I can't remember what we said we were going to call this
community
segment,
questions,
but we just want to answer as many questions possible, so people were leaving questions on the forums and YouTube. Just leave questions wherever. I don't really care. Maybe Adam's more picky. What do you think?
I don't mind. As long as I can find the questions, that's fine.
All right. We missed some questions last week, so we'll try to get through as many questions right now as possible. Let's see what we got here. Question, what server are you guys playing on? Well, we already said that, right? We're playing on Xanadu, and we said where we were located. F something.
Mm-hmm.
Do you remember?
F 13,
F 12,
something
like that.
Somewhere in
there. Anyway, next question. Lawworm said, is this a prelude to more videos specifically leaning towards gameplay and or streaming gameplay, or will you guys be playing it by ear? Given the flexibility of your time and real-life commitments. Didn't we answer this question last week? I don't remember.
I don't think we answered this question, but... I think that...
Are we going to do more videos? I think so.
Yeah, we're going to do more videos. I think that as time permits and as... We're I don't know if you noticed, but we're sort of adopting sort of a fly-by-the-seat-of-our-pants sort of... format, like to call it.
It's a good way to call it.
Our plan is that we're going to make these as easy to make as possible. So we can hit the record button and just go and not have to really worry too much about what's happening after or before.
Yes.
So the idea is the new format will be we are going to choose sort of a project to do. And maybe that project will last more than one episode or not. And we're going to do that project while we talk worm stuff. So I think that as time permits, we're going to be continuing to make videos.
Yeah. Anything on the forums that's happening, any events that are going on, anything to do with Wurm, any news about the game, we're just going to be talking.
Mm-hmm.
That's an interesting question. Are we going to stream even when you're not working on an episode? Probably not, unfortunately, right now.
I'll be honest. I personally
don't have time.
You know, yeah, that's true. I personally I don't know about you guys, but
I don't sit at the computer that you're sitting at right now.
Well, that's that. Besides that, I don't like watching streams where it's just somebody playing. You know what I mean?
Don't.
You know,
the fact that we don't have time in the end, like,
well, that too.
Now, have we talked about the email that was sent out earlier today? I did not receive an email.
I did not receive an email too.
I am currently feeling rejected right now.
Let me check my spam folder, which sometimes it ends up in.
Spam folder.
Nope. I did not receive an email.
Something about challenge server. Well, if we pretend that we had got this email, and it's like something about challenge server, I can only guess something to do with that the challenge server is going to reopen at some date in the future, and it's going to be different and altered and tweaked a little bit. That's my guess.
Yeah. I might need you to come over here and start this thing.
Or what thing? Sorry.
This fireplace. I'll get it.
I will do the fireplace while you move the pine wood.
I'll be honest, all of this stuff, my character can't really make it.
I have a 25% chance. Here.
Okay, there's the fireplace stuff. What am I moving? This looks nice.
See the fireplace stuff. Okay.
Yeah, I'll move stuff. That I can do.
We'll be the mover. Anyway, next question. Keegan, with the word that we can name and shame, is there anyone you would like to name and shame? Okay. Name and shame. I would like to name... Who do we like to name?
See,
I haven't really thought about that.
I like this question is because it brings up an interesting conversation piece about how at one point everybody sort of had this idea that then there was this name and shame rule, which you couldn't name and shame people on the forums publicly or otherwise, but then Enki comes on and says there is no such rule, and so people created this official name and shame thread where they just started talking about people and their wrongdoings. And personally, I wish I could name and shame this one person who's been around our deed and secretly been stealing stuff. But I wish, I don't know who it was, but there is somebody in our neighborhood who's actively stealing anything they can get their hands on that isn't locked down. Which,
yeah,
arguably,
stolen from us.
Arguably isn't my fault for not locking it down. But at the same time, I wish I could know who it is so that I can name and shame them.
It was a bug, wasn't it?
No, it turned out that it was just my idiocy.
You allowed people to pick up things on our deed?
No, actually, and this is something that might be quite useful to many of you out there. If you have a cart or a boat on your deed that's not locked, people can still take from it, even though they're not allowed to pick up stuff from your deed.
And you kept a cart?
A feature of the game. So, alternatively, if you see a cart unlocked on deed, its contents are pretty much not protected by deed permissions, so that's that. And nor is it protected by any of the rules in the game, so it's not considered griefing to take stuff from it. I personally would like to see that rule changed, but I'm not about to cry over the lost items. I think next time I'll just lock it, and that's the way it is.
Alright, so next question by Typical. Could you talk about driving tips? I'm not entirely sure what that means. Maybe something to do with driving a horse?
When I first saw this question, my immediate thought went back to Chonk Lord. If you remember, he was a villager of ours way back, and he's not playing anymore. Yeah. But I remember the first time he got into a cart, and he was just like all over the place. He could not figure out for the life of him how to get that cart to go the way that he wanted to. So I was like thinking maybe he's talking
about
that.
That's almost like another video. We'll have to make a video on that maybe.
Yeah, I know.
It's not that hard, but for new players, maybe it's it'll be useful. There's like a little delay. Think of it like if you're riding a cart and you have to tell the horse, you know, turn left, and what do? You like whip the reins or whatever, and then the horse sort of like, okay, fine, I'll do it. And then you move. So there's like this delay of like telling the horse to go, and then he goes. And so you just have to realize that it's not going to turn left once you press left. It's going to take a little delay to do that. I don't know if it's always been just because of the lag in the game, or if that's a feature. I mean, it's just the way that it's always been, so you get used to it.
Now, I watched a video long before of some person who was basically saying that this way of controlling the cart is new, and at some point prior to that, it was just straight up, you press to the right and it moves to the right without a delay. And he was complaining about it, but personally, I like that delay. I think that it adds something to the realism of the game.
Yeah. I'm pretty sure it's still partly the lag anyway. This game does have a lot of lag because of where the server's located. Anyway, next question. Interloper said, do you feel that after your experience in Ebonora that this game is heavily biased towards PvE, as some people suggest? Or do you feel that this ties in with Rolf's decisions such as releasing server after server for the Freedom Cluster? What do you think for the first question there?
You know, I think that on the chaos. The game is... It's obvious that the development of the game does have some PvP elements to it, that there is some focus there, and there is an audience for the PvP. But my feeling is that if you broke down all of the updates to the game over the past, you know, couple years or whatever, and you just categorize them PvE change, PvP change, there is, I would say, a heavy leaning towards the PvE side, which is nice because I think that the PvE has a higher population in terms of people who play it. But
you're right.
But at the same time, there is focus on PvP. I think there's a nice balance right now between the two. I know that the PvP people are very passionate. Like you look on the forums and it almost feels like on the forums there's just as many PvP players as there are PvE. But so they're very vocal about their stuff, which is good. It does help get things done. Keeping in mind, Challenge is the newest server, and it is a PvP-centric server.
So you think that the game is or is not heavily biased towards PvE?
I'd say that it's not biased either way. If there is a bias, I don't think it does leak into the game too much. I know that... And I've heard, I don't know for a fact personally, but I've heard that Rolf would love the game to be a PvP game. There's a lot of features in the game that do lend themselves to the PvP concepts. Personally, like I like the idea of PvP in this game, but I just can't with the playtime that I have. I love the PvE stuff too. I love this deed building and decorating rooms. Like this is loads of fun for me. So if it were up to me, it would be all PvE, I think, in terms of development. But as far as the bias in the dev team goes, I think that the bias is towards PvP, but I don't think that that's really affected their development on PvE stuff. That's my feeling anyway.
Okay. Well, you know us, we're PvEers, but you know, it doesn't mean you can't add PvP elements, you know? Max, thanks? I don't know how to say it. I'm just gonna call him Max. Do you think that bridges and boat collision will drastically alter the landscape and waterways of Wurm? This is, and do you think this will be a positive change, or are you excited to see how it will develop once live? So I'm assuming this means that boats are going to change their collision. Are they going to hit bridges or something? They're not going to be able to go through them?
I've read a little bit about this. I'm not 100% sure.
Is that confirmed?
I feel like what they want is that the boats will hit ground when any part of the boat hits ground, sort of thing. Not just the center. I think as well they want it so that you can sit on the boats and all that sort of stuff.
Sit on the boats, that'd be nice. But
there, Buddha's clearing it up for me. Boats won't hit bridges. That's probably the main reason why they started doing all this. My initial fear was that it would affect boat mines, but then there was some comment that it won't. I don't think that the collision's gonna affect much in terms of how we experience the game. We might notice a little bit more of the details, but bridges are gonna affect the landscape immensely. It's gonna change the way that deeds are built, even.
Yeah, I don't even know how it works. Like, would you be able to build a bridge out into the water? I guess you would have to raise the land somewhere. Or, let's say, from one island to the other island. Can you do that?
I think you can as build long as you bridge. Make land bridges. You know, like, not bridges, but land, like little, maybe a 2x2 spot to put a...
I see. So there must be like a limit of how far a bridge can.
I'm pretty sure there's a limit, and I'm pretty sure based on some sort of skill. Yeah, probably. And
maybe put it to the test server, we'd be able to find that out, but we don't. Eventually, we'll figure that out. But I am looking forward to bridges, of course. I think everyone is, specifically, to play around with them on our deed. Really, we have a whole bunch of ideas on what to do with them, and a whole bunch of new ideas on what to do in the future for future projects, which I don't think we're going to bring up in this episode.
No, yeah.
But Zada's still believes that bridges will have more negative than positive effects on Wurm. Mm-hmm. That's a bold statement. Yes.
It's possible that what we're going to see are lots of areas built up with lots of bridges and then abandoned. Like, for example, somebody builds a highway or something like that and then just never upkeeps it or never repairs things on it.
Yeah, would you have to upkeep a bridge?
Yeah,
like,
I don't know.
It becomes part of the highway.
Yeah.
And then it rots away.
It's hard to say.
If it has the same sort of decay ability as everything else in this game, like fences, it's just going to go away, and then people aren't going to be able to go across the highway anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Unless it has a long decay. It stays long like pavement. And then it would be hard to... you just see bridges everywhere. Maybe a way around that would be to have it so bridges are easy to remove.
Do you mean repair?
No, like if they stayed for a long time, like pavement.
Okay.
Also make it easy to get rid of.
I see.
If you own the land. Huh?
I see. I know that that pavement decays if it's not being used. Like if there's a road there and nobody's walking along that road, over time it decays.
Maybe right. So it could have that same sort of pavement rule. I don't know.
Because if nobody's using the bridge, then there's no reason to have the bridge. I don't know.
Right.
That's a hard question. And I know that they've been doing testing and there's like lots of stuff going on with bridges. In the initial round of testing, they removed the ability to connect a bridge to buildings, which probably adds a lot more problems. Although that's the feature I've been waiting for. Like, I know that if that feature came in, I could connect a building to a land or building to building with a bridge. I have bridges that are ready to go. Like, I'll build them right away. And many more ideas surrounding that.
Yes.
But if bridges come out and you have to do it land to land, that's going to limit their functionality a lot. And it's, yeah. Oh, bridge to buildings work now. Yay! That would be awesome. I can't. That makes me very
happy.
That's
exactly what we need.
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Oh, okay, good. So now all my plans are back in play. Can't wait. This is a lot of the reason why I'm waiting on a lot of the buildings here is because just all these ideas, and I can't build it yet until the bridges are in. And the worst is to build everything without them in there and then realizing, oh, I should have done it this way because this is how the bridge, you know, bridges are working. And
right.
Yeah. Just can't wait.
So, yeah, that would be great. We do have lots of plans for bridges, and I sort of almost want to design an entirely new area once the bridges come out. Just to try out the bridges. Huh? Wouldn't that be fun? Especially in this deed, we have a lot of platforms that could be linked together. So we'll see.
Mm-hmm.
But I can't wait. Next question is from Renewed Path. Let's see which questions you write down here. What were the most important details you learned when you went to Chaos and things that you would mention to someone that's thinking of going?
Mm. That's a good question.
That's so a question for you.
Well, as I mentioned in the last episode, Chaos was a lot of like a shroud of mystery before going, and after coming back, I feel like I understand the basics. I think that the biggest thing about Chaos that you need to know going into it is that politics plays a huge role, that just the people there, because people play in large groups, knowing who's who and who the key players are is a big deal. I think that if you are planning on going to Chaos, just make sure you have a good amount of playtime. I don't think that PvP is feasible if you're only going to be playing casually. That's like a couple hours here and there every
now,
other
people,
day.
Now, people, I think, sorry.
But yeah, go ahead.
People, I think, mistaken the fact that I'm going to a PvP server. Does that mean I'm going to be PvPing all the time? Mm. Like, is this what you're saying? Like, you need so much time to play because there's all this PvP going on, or can you clarify that?
There is very little PvP going on compared to regular worming. By regular worming, I mean building and crafting and skilling and all that. It completely depends, you know. Like I was talking to one of our friends from Ebonora, Pekka, actually, who's a villager of ours, and he's still over there, and he said that within the last couple weeks they had four encounters where they had to fight, and they've started winning apparently, which is very, very awesome to hear. But that seems like a lot to me, and maybe that's sort of normal. I don't know, because when I was over there, it was a lot of us just starting up, and I know that for sure. That's probably what happens when you first start up, and maybe PvP starts increasing as you become more established. But for the most part, it's a lot of deed building. I'd say that if you wanted to split the time,
why do you need to be there for more time than you would for, I don't know, for PvE, if it's doing what you do on PvE most of the time?
What do you mean? Oh, more time?
Why would you need to spend more time than on PvP than you would on PvE? I mean, that's one of the main reasons why you came back.
I see. Well, one of the main reasons why I came back specifically is because I AFK a lot. And there was a lot of things that were going on, like we wanted to go cap towers and potentially go attack something or other. But if I'm going to go on one of these events, then I'm going to have to be sitting in front of my computer on TeamSpeak the whole time. I probably couldn't go AFK, or if I did, it would have to be like a one-time quick thing, and then I'm back sort of thing. I can't just be like, you know what, guys, I just something's going on here. I have to go for 20 minutes or whatever. I'm just going to leave my guy here. That's not going to work, really. So, and that seemed to happen a lot. I was running into that situation where I'm like, you know what? I'm just going to have to stay back this time, and you guys go ahead, because I might have to leave at any time. And that was happening a lot. So it almost seemed like all I was doing was PvEing and missing out on all the PvP stuff. And there was also the prospect of losing all my stuff due to the fact that I couldn't actively participate. You know, an enemy enters into local, and you can't really log off at that point. And if you do, your character just stays there for, what, 5 minutes or something?
Oh, yes. So that is... you're right.
So I would have had to be just like, you know what? Forget it. You take my stuff, I gotta go. And I just really didn't like that feeling, because I really couldn't commit my time to the screen. But if you can, this is something like, if you can do that, then, and you're interested in Chaos, then for sure, lots of fun to be had there.
All right, so I think the last question here is also what we chose to be the question of the week.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, and I guess this person's gonna win. What did you say?
It will be a saddle.
A saddle that is something quality with something WOA.
Yeah, it's posted in the thread. Yay!
Yeah. What is it exactly? So, what is the question? The question is from Dragonelle. And it's quite a long question. Let's see. As we all know, the new player learning curve is quite steep. So if you go from not playing to trying to learn this game, it is quite steep. I myself had tried the game out and was fairly intimidating experience early on, knowing no one and having little skills. And I think everyone has that problem at the beginning. At the time, I was like many new players. I started alone. I kept to myself. I didn't ask many questions, and I ended up quitting. I returned after a few months later and gave it a shot, another shot, and found a place to stay that had active, helpful folks. If I had more knowledge beforehand, I most likely wouldn't have been so intimidated. My question is, what are your thoughts on what can be done by the developers, the game, or even the community itself to bring the game to a wider audience, and how to retain new players? Wow. Everybody, I don't know, in the chat right now, what do you guys think? How do we bring more people into the game? And then how do we keep them around after they come?
And I think that there's even something that you can tack on to the end of this, and that is, how do you keep veteran players around too? Because I know that a lot of people there are a lot of people who play for, you know, a year, year and a half, 2 years, and then they leave and they never come back. That happens all the time. This is a hard question because of the type of game that this is, and we know after discussing this so many times that this is a very niche game in the sense that it's not for everybody. It's hard to explain this game to anybody, and then, you know, even have it sound like it's a fun game to play. It's a really hard.
Or even have it sound like it's a game.
Yeah, I know.
A lot of people that listen to me talking about it, and they're just like,
"That's
like,
a game.
When does the game start?"
A lot
it's
of
very
stuff
hard to wrap your head around.
A lot of stuff has been done by the developers to make this game more newbie friendly, and I think a lot of these changes have done a lot in terms of retaining people for a little bit longer than they would have normally.
I think,
like, the newbie buffs and the...
Yes, there was definitely a push for a while to gain more players into the game. I can't remember when this was. To get more players into the game and to try to keep them by making it easier for new players.
Yeah.
This was over a year ago.
They also added the ability to...
I can't remember exactly why they did it.
For a new player to start a deed. That was a big change.
That's right.
As far as the development goes, I think they just need to keep going with what they're doing. It is the type of game where if you start tailoring it to the newbies, then the veterans aren't gonna like it. You know, like, it's gonna change the game for them. I think that the balance has been...
It's a hard question to answer. The first question is a little easier. How do you gain more players? You advertise, right? You get the game on Steam, you get the game on, you know, all these places. Can the game handle it? Probably not. Mm-hmm. Probably we can't handle 5,000 new players logging in at the same time. But...
Or can we handle 5,000 new players coming in and saying, this sucks, and on Steam getting
there, there's
a ton
the
of...
problem. You've got one chance. Let's say with Steam, right, everyone says, okay, add the game to Steam. But you have one chance when you add the game to Steam. You add it to Steam, you get all these players all at the same time looking at your game for the first time, logging in. Obviously, Wurm can't handle this, the pressure. The game's going to crash over and over again. There's going to be so much lag. And by the time the devs team figures out how to fix all these problems, everyone's already left.
And there's 10,000 reviews.
Somehow solve this
negative
problem.
Reviews.
Yeah. Exactly. Well, I can't even play this game.
There goes our cart somehow. There goes our cart.
So, at some point, there needs to be a slower way to bring people into the game, right? There needs to be a more natural way to do it, because it's not more about like getting the word out as much as it is getting the word out to the right people at the right time. So that the game can be playable for all. And there needs to be a balance, right? Because as players start playing, more money gets invested, more money comes in, more money gets invested into the game. And then repeat. And it just has to keep going like that. And as more money gets invested into the game, hopefully the game gets developed a bit more. It can't be all at once. It can't just be, you know, boom, 10,000 people joining the game, and now we have all this money, and we're going to fix all these problems, and the game's going to go soaring. And sort of doesn't really work like that. I mean, unless there's like a lot of capital and just throw money at it and then hope that you reimburse that money later. But this game doesn't seem like a game like that. So they could gain a lot of players, I think, by just advertising in the right places. But then how do you keep those players? That's the tough part. You only want to keep the players that the game is geared towards. No, you're not going to keep the players that are used to the combat of everything else, and that's why they're playing. It needs to be more. This is more a social game, as much as some players would like to play solo. This game is more fun playing socially with people. And the game needs to be geared towards those kinds of players. Mm-hmm. I don't know if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. The players that want to build up a community, because you're not only playing for the game, but you're also playing for the community. You play for the game and you stay for the community.
Right.
And with that kind of thinking, then that means that after you learn the game and after you say, I like this game, I want to stick around, then the features that come after that should be features based around community play, because it's the community that's going to keep you around to play. It's going to be your friendly neighbors and your friendly, all these events that happen and all these things that players make or that run these events
Projects.
You know, logging in and seeing your friends on and the projects that you do with your friends, that's what keeps you around. So why not build game features that promote that as well? Mm-hmm. Which goes back to like village leveling and all this stuff that we talked about, group building and like stuff that just promotes tools that allow players to build unique stuff. I don't know if that makes sense. Tools that, for example, how about the ability to be able to... We built a labyrinth. How about tools that could be utilized towards building like trap doors or just things that...
Secret doors, that would be awesome.
Creative ways of doing things that you could utilize for community play in different ways. Anyway, that's my
couple things. There's a couple things in the chat. So Buddha brings up, I think it was your unofficial trailer that you did a while ago that was the best thing that I'd seen that describes Wurm and why it's so good. And I would have to agree.
Whatever happened to that trailer?
It's still around.
Still on our YouTube channel somewhere.
On our YouTube channel, still find it. I don't think it's on the website anymore because there's a new one, but yeah, that was great.
That was pretty great to make.
Yeah. It's good to make it. It turned out really nice. I think people need to be friendlier to new players. A lot of people are not nice to new players. That's probably because many players don't stick around, and the time invested in them would not be worth the effort, because new players tend to be destructive nature, and it's a cycle. And that is somewhat true, although I think that it's a lot about the attitude of some new players, you know, where they come in and they just want to loot stuff and they want to kill things, and they have like this immature attitude that happens from time to time. But a lot of times, I'd say the majority of new players that I meet are actually really mature and nice and willing to learn. And I don't know. I've met quite a few new players since I moved here, and it's been kind of refreshing.
You know what I want? I want secret buttons that are placed on the ground that if you step on them, like a door unlocks. But then I want it to be so that you would need two players, and there'd be like two, they're not buttons. What would you call them? I'm just going to call them buttons. So there'd be like in a room, there'd be two places where two people would have to stand to unlock a door or to activate something. Huh?
You're talking about redstone.
I don't know what I'm talking about. I don't know what that is. But
you don't know what that
I
is?
Want something that that's customizable.
Yeah. Huh? Redstone. It's that stuff redstone. In Minecraft. That allows you to activate stuff.
I never
stuff.
Played Minecraft. Yeah, pressure plates, there you go.
Pressure plates, yeah.
but something that you would allow you to, use in multiple different ways.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't know why cool. I'm bringing this stuff up. Anyway, that was our question of the day.
Question of the week.
Of the week. And... I think that concludes everything. How does our room look?
It looks somewhat started.
what do you guys think? How does our room look? What is it missing? What do you like about it? What should we do from now on for the rest of the week for this room to be completed? Let us know. Let us know on YouTube. Let us know on the forums. I'm sure you will. You'll post something on the forums, right, Adam?
Yeah.
And just we will probably do whatever you guys say and finish up this room during the week sometime.
Oh, wash basin. That's a good one. Didn't even think of that.
Yeah, it's a good idea. More bookshelves.
Small.
Definitely.
Small.
I don't think you can have enough bookshelves.
Bedside table. We need. Bedside tables.
Yes. We'll have to just keep making stuff and putting it around and seeing what it looks like without getting it too cluttered. But it should be nice. Did that fire go out?
Yeah, I think that fireplaces don't last that long. I don't know why that is.
That's okay. It's probably like a forge. So I think that's it for the week. It's been great talking. This is like the longest I've talked to Adam since last week. I don't know how long it's been. I think we just recorded probably our longest episode. Wow, we just keep talking.
Yep.
We literally don't shut up when we hit the record button. Anyway, thanks a lot, guys. Next week we will have another project that we do, and we'll see what that is. I don't know. We'll figure it out. Anyway, thanks everyone for watching. Go to our YouTube channel. Go to Twitch. Check us out next week, probably next Monday. Next Monday, what day is that? I don't know. February something. I should really know this stuff. February 16th, we'll probably record again. This is EST sometime around 8:30, as long as Adam's internet doesn't go out again.
Yeah.
At this point, Adam is going to have to be the one that streams it until I get some better internet connection. But I think it worked out well. Thank you for hosting it, Adam, for the first time.
Yep, no problem.
And thank you everyone for watching on Twitch. Thank you for everyone watching on YouTube after. And we'll see you guys next week. Take care, everyone.